Royal Caribbean's newest cruise ship, Icon of the Seas, is heralded as the largest passenger ship ever. With a gross tonnage of 250,800, the ship eclipses the largest Oasis-class ship, Wonder of the Seas, with an increase in gross tonnage of 14,000, or the size of a small cruise ship. So what is gross tonnage, and how exactly do they weigh a ship? Will they sit Icon of the Seas on a giant set of scales, or is there another way to calculate the ship's size? Stick around to find out.
Hello, and for those of you who don't know me, my name's Chris Frame, and I'm a maritime history author and lecturer. I speak on board cruise ships and at maritime museums around the world. If you're interested in cruising, cruise ships, or maritime history, I think you're gonna like it here. So hopefully you'll subscribe at the end of the video.
The first thing to understand is that gross tonnage, the measure that we use for cruise ships today, is not a weight measurement. Rather, gross tonnage is a standard non-linear measure of a ship's overall internal volume, so no scales are required here. As a measurement, gross tonnage has been the standard since 1969, when the International Convention on Tonnage Measurement of Ships was taken up by the International Maritime Organisation. The convention came into complete effect in 1982, and since then, all passenger ship tonnage, regardless of the age of the ship, has been measured in gross tonnage. The calculation to work out gross tonnage is a bit mind-bending, and as I'm not a mathematician, I won't try and explain all the calculations. However, I've put them up on the screen for those of you who are interested. For the purposes of this video, what you need to know is that gross tonnage is calculated by a logarithmic relationship between the ship's total volume in cubic meters, V, and a multiplier, K. The implementation of gross tonnage was a significant step forward to standardize the measurement of a ship's size across national borders. Prior to this, there were numerous national standards, but no true international agreement. Gross registered tonnage, or GRT, was one of the most common older measurements that you may have heard of. It is the measure that you'll often hear used for historic ships like Titanic, and is often mixed up with gross tonnage. GRT was devised by the Mawson Commission all the way back in 1849. The measure, of British origin, calculated the size of a ship by the internal volume. Like the gross tonnage that succeeded it, GRT is an internal volume-based measure. However, here, the volume used in the calculation was based on the British imperial system. The British Board of Trade, as well as many other nations, used this measurement, but there were a number of countries that had their own unique measurements as well. Add to this the difference in British imperial units with those of the US, for example, and there was often confusion as to which measurement a ship was following. This makes it tricky for people to compare sizes of ships from the past across national borders, given the potential variance in the measurement. Basically, the takeaway here is that gross tonnage and gross registered tonnage are volume-based measurements, not weight measurements, and they are quite different measures. A great example to illustrate this can be seen with the iconic P&O liner Canberra. As the ship was built before 1982, she was originally measured in GRT, clocking in at 44,807. However, when the ship's tonnage was recalculated in gross tonnage, she appeared to be a larger vessel at 49,073. In reality, it was the measurement that changed, not the ship's overall size. So now we know what gross tonnage is, and that it is the standard measurement to express the size of a passenger ship today. But what about the actual weight of a ship? Do we need scales for that? Well, no, because for this we can turn to displacement. Displacement is calculated using Archimedes' principle, with the displaced water being converted into a weight value. This again bypasses any need to stick a cruise ship on a giant set of scales. Historically, an imperial measure of long tons was used, but today we generally talk in the metric measure. Displacement is not the same as a deadweight tonnage, another term that you might have heard. Deadweight tonnage is not a measure of the ship's physical size per se, but rather the total weight that the ship can carry. And finally, what about net tonnage? This is often shown on various shipping articles as an additional measurement for size. Net tonnage is also a volume-based measure, implemented under the same 1969 convention as gross tonnage that we talked about earlier. This measure is calculated based on the total molded volume of the ship's cargo spaces. Net tonnage replaced net registered tonnage, which has the same basic logic behind it as gross registered tonnage. And since 1982, this has also been the standard for all ships. So there you have it. Clear as mud, right? Well, in reality, most of us are only going to need to worry about gross tons, as that is the international standard measure for all passenger ships today. This means when you see Icon of the Seas gross tonnage as 250,800, you can visualize a difference in scale compared to Queen Mary 2 at 149,200. Bear in mind, however, that the internal volume of a ship doesn't mean that one ship is bigger than another in all dimensions. With a gross tonnage of 70,327, QE2, for example, was significantly smaller than Pacific Adventure, yet QE2 was a longer ship. Pacific Adventure, however, had a far larger internal volume and is much, much bulkier. And on the topic of Pacific Adventure, keep an eye out on the channel for a full tour of that exciting new P&O Australia ship coming soon. Thanks so much for watching. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button. And until next time, I hope to see you on board.